In the next few lectures, we are going to study the concept of threading and concurrency. So before we understand what threads are, let's just review what we've seen so far. Right? So far, we have studied single-threaded programs. So what is a single-threaded program? There is one thread of execution. So here is your memory image. And when this process is executing on the CPU, all of this, the program code, data, heap, stack, everything is in memory. And the CPU register, the program counter register, is pointing to some instruction in the program code. And the stack pointer register is pointing to the current stack frame, depending on where you are in your function calls, right? And then the CPU is executing instruction by instruction as the PC moves to instruction by instruction, right? So this is called a single-threaded program. That is just one flow of execution through the program code. You go through the program code in some order using one thread of execution. But a program can also have multiple threads of execution, right? So what is a thread? In a multi-threaded program, you have multiple lines of execution through your code simultaneously. So a thread is just like another copy of a process that executes on the same code. So if your program has two threads, right, you're going to have two program counters. One program counter is pointing to some line of code and executing here. The other program counter is pointing to some other line of code executing here. And both these threads are executing together at the same time on the same program, right? So threads, they share the address space. They share the same code. They share the same heap and so on. But each thread has a separate program counter. Like when one thread is executing, the PC register in the CPU has one value. When another thread is executing, it has another value because different threads are running at different points of the program. And another subtle point is each thread also has a separate stack. So it's easy to see why each thread must have a separate program counter, right? Because different threads execute. It's like you're running different versions of the program and each version is at different points in the code. But each thread also has a separate stack. And why is that? Because each thread makes different function calls, right? Thread one has made some function call and it has set some arguments and so on. Thread two is at a different point of the code. It's made a different function call. Therefore, different threads also have their own separate stacks. So in the single-threaded program, you just had one stack in the memory image, and now you're going to have multiple stack pointers and multiple stacks in the memory image of the program. Right? So what is the difference between processes and threads? For example, if a process P forks a child C, what happens? This is P's memory image. You have the code, heap, stack, and everything, and this is C's memory image. The memory image of C is an exact copy of the memory image of P, but P and C do not share any memory, right? If P wants to send some data to C, then you need to have complex IPC mechanisms, like, you know, you have a segment of a page of shared memory, or, you know, you have a pipe or a queue, you pass something along. It is in general very hard for two processes to communicate easily, right? And also, if you're running multiple copies of the same program, then you have extra copies of the code and data in memory and so on, right? So there are, if you want to run the same process multiple times on the machine, then forking is not such a great idea to do it, because communicating between these copies is hard and you also use up more memory for extra copies of the code. On the other hand, if you want your same process to run multiple times, the same code to execute multiple versions of it in parallel, then you simply, it's easier to create threads, right? So when you create threads, here is a program P that has two threads of execution. One thread is running here, one thread is running here. Then both these threads share the same code, heap, and everything. Therefore, you have a smaller memory footprint. At the same time, because both of these threads share the same variables and so on, communication is easy, right? You can simply use global variables to communicate between the threads. You declare a global variable in your code, then both threads, no matter even if they're running at different points of the code, can access the same global variables, right? So communicating is easy. So in general, if you have multiple versions of the same process running, you might want these processes to communicate, to exchange information, saying, hey, I did this, you do this, and so on. So all of that becomes easier if you use threads instead of processes. So threads are just like separate processes. So creating a multi-threaded program is just like creating multiple, it's just like running multiple versions of the same program simultaneously. Just that they all share the same code, same variables, and so on. Right? So now that we understand what threads are, why do we need threads? Right? Why do we want to run multiple versions of the same program? So one important reason is what is called parallelism. If you have a multi-core CPU, right, and you have a process P running on this CPU, then the other CPU core is idle, right? In that case, if you want your program to get better performance, utilize all your hardware, then you might want to run another version of the program on the other CPU core in order to effectively utilize the hardware, right? At this point, I'd like you to understand a difference between two related but slightly different terms called concurrency and parallelism. So what is concurrency? Concurrency is running multiple threads or processes at the same time. Even if you have one CPU core, right? You have one CPU core, you can have process P1, process P2 running concurrently on the same CPU core. This is concurrency. You need not have multiple cores for concurrency. You can have just a single CPU core, multiple processes running at the same time with their executions interleaved, right? So a few instructions of one process runs, then it is context switched out, then the next process, few more instructions, stop, back to first process, then to the second process, and so on. So you can interleave executions of multiple processes. This is called concurrency. On the other hand, parallelism is multiple processes or threads running over different CPU cores, right? You have process 1 running here, process 2 running here at the same time in parallel over different CPU cores, right? So when if you use multiple threads, you can easily exploit parallelism. You can easily make use of the multiple CPU cores on a multi-core machine. Most machines today are multi-core and you can get better performance. But what if you have just a single core machine? Do you still need threads? Yes, you do. Even if there is no scope for parallelism, concurrently running multiple threads is still useful because one of the threads of a program can block. For example, if you have two threads of a process on a single CPU core, if suppose thread one blocks, it has, you know, requested to read a disk from the block, requested to read a block from the disk, and it cannot proceed anymore. It has been suspended. In that case, your CPU is lying idle, right? So if your program has another thread, that thread can come in and keep executing when this thread is gone, right? So typically, processes or threads make blocking system calls and cannot run continuously. So during the times when one thread runs, then it takes a break, then another thread runs, then another thread runs, right? So here is T1, here is T2, then again you're back to T1. So if you have multiple threads, you can interleave their executions and you can get better performance even if you do not have multiple CPU cores, right? So that is why we need threads in order to get better performance from the underlying hardware, both on multi-core as well as single-core machines. So note that the operating system schedules threads much the same way as it schedules processes, right? So every thread is treated like an independent process. So the context of a thread, when a thread is context switched out, so just like you save the context of a process in a process control block, a PCB, every thread has a thread control block called TCB, right? So if a process has multiple threads, each PCB has multiple TCB is linked with it, okay? And whenever this thread is being context switched out, its context is saved in its TCB, and when it resumes again, it is restored from its TCB, right? So the operating system maintains a list of processes, and within each PCB, there is a list of TCBs. And threads are in general scheduled independently by the kernel, and such threads are called kernel threads, right? By default, when we say a program has multiple threads, we mean it has multiple kernel threads. That is, at the operating system level, these are separate entities that are scheduled independently by the kernel. For example, we are going to see many examples from the Linux pthreads library, right? So these are implemented as kernel threads. Anytime you create a thread, the operating system sees a separate schedulable entity. So in contrast, some libraries provide only user level threads. So these are not very common, and we are not going to touch upon them too much in this course, but it is good to know that not all threads are kernel threads. Sometimes some libraries give you functions to create threads, but they don't actually go ahead and create a thread at the operating system level, right? So in the user space, you're going to be able to see multiple threads of execution, but in the kernel space, there's only going to be a smaller number of threads, and these user level threads are going to be multiplexed over a smaller number of kernel threads, right? The user thinks he has created 10,000 threads, but the kernel only sees it as five different processes or five different threads, right? So why are user level threads used? It's just an easy way to give the user an illusion of having a thread without having too much overhead, right? So it is, there is a lower overhead in switching between user threads because the kernel is not involved, there's no context switch and so on. The library itself switches between the multiple threads and so on. But on the other hand, these are also not very useful because these multiple user threads cannot run in parallel. The kernel only sees it as one thread, even though the user sees it as 20 different threads. Right? So you lose your some of your parallelism gains. So this is a subtle point why we need user level threads that we are probably not going to touch too much upon in this lecture. What is important to remember is by default, when we say a thread, it is a kernel level thread. When a process creates a thread, the kernel sees it as a separate entity that it can schedule independently. So here is a small example of code where you create multiple threads, right? So these are all based on the pthreads library. This is a standard library that you use to create threads in C programs in Linux. So here is your main program, and here is the important function, right? There is a pthread create function. This function creates another thread. Now here is your process P, your main process, there's a main thread of execution, and then you have created two threads, T1 and T2, right? You've created two threads. So now there are three threads of execution, okay? And to this thread, you give a thread variable, then forget about the second argument. And here is your important argument. What is this? You're giving the name of a function so that this thread, when it starts, will start executing this function. And you're passing an argument to this function. And this thread is simply printing that argument, right? So what happens when this program runs? A new thread is created. That new thread is going to print A. Another thread is created. That thread is going to print B. And finally, this process P actually waits for both of these threads to finish. There is a join function. This join function waits for the thread to finish execution. And after both the threads finish execution, the finally this parent thread is going to print end, right? So this is what is going to happen. There are going to be three schedulable entities, and they can get scheduled. For example, T2 can get scheduled before T1, and B can get printed before A. That can also happen. Whatever it is, these three entities are scheduled in some order by the operating system, and they all run concurrently, right? So here is a more realistic example. In general, you create multiple threads because you want them to do some job together, right? So you have a global variable counter, and you once again create multiple threads, and you give all of them this function to run. And in this function, you increment a shared variable, right? So here you've created two threads. Let's call them T1, T2, or thread A and B. And each of them print A and B after they increment a counter 10 to the 7 times, right? Is that clear? So what do you expect this program to do? There is a counter with the value 0. You've created two threads. One thread increments it 10 to the 7 times. The other thread increments it 10 to the 7 times. And when the parent finishes, it prints out the final value of the counter, right? So what do you expect will happen? You would expect something like this to happen, right? The first thread has started, it has finished. The next thread has started, it has finished, and after both of them increment the counter 10 to the 7 times each, you see a final value of 2 into 10 to the 7. But if you run the simple piece of code many times, sometimes you're going to see a different value and you're going to keep seeing different values different times, right? So this is the problem with threads. Welcome to the tricky world of multi-threaded programming. So why is this happening? Is there some bug in the code? No, this is actually very much expected behavior, right? When multiple threads access the same shared piece of data, all sorts of weird things can happen, right? So let's dig into that example. Here is your simple line, counter equal to counter plus one, right? So this translates to some code like this. In assembly language, this one line of C code is made up of three instructions. First, you move whatever value is there in this, you know, this is your counter variable. You move this value into this register. Then you increment the register and then you store back the value from the register into the counter, right? So the single line of C code is actually three instructions. And suppose these instructions are laid out in memory at these addresses at 100, 105, 108, right? This instruction is 5 bytes, therefore the next instruction starts at 105, 108, and so on, right? So when you're executing, when two threads are running the same line of code at the same time, let's just once see what is happening, right? You have thread 1, thread 2, both of them increment. Suppose the counter starts at the value 50, you want it to eventually reach the value 52, right? That is what is your goal. But is it happening? Let us see. So thread 1, first it runs, the program counter is pointing to 105 instructions. So it fetches this 100 instruction first. It moves the value of counter. This value 50 is moved into the EAX register. And then you add 1 to the register. At this point, you have just about to run 108. The last instruction of storing this 51 back into the counter, right? At this point, thread 1 is interrupted and you jump to thread 2, right? The OS comes in, saves thread 1's context, all its registers, everything, jumps to thread 2. And now thread 2 also, what does it do? It executes the same code again. Now your counter is still 50, right? We have incremented the register, but we have not updated the counter. So your counter is still 50. It will also read it into the register, increment it, and now this thread gets to store back the value 51 in the counter, right? So this thread finished its execution. Now what happens? You switch back to thread 1. Now thread 1, when it resumes, it had this value 51 stored in its register, right? So it's going to start from there and it's going to say, okay, I have this value in my register. The next instruction I have to store is store this value back into the counter, and therefore the counter once again gets a value of 51. But what did we want? We would have ideally wanted 52, but that didn't happen. Why? Because these executions overlapped. Both of them started with the old value of the counter 50, incremented it to 51 and wrote back 51. When ideally you should have wanted, what should have happened ideally? And most of the time, so this is a very corner case, right? This kind of scheduling. It may not always happen like this. Most of the times what will happen is thread 1 will increment this counter to 51, write it back to memory. Then the next thread will read 51, increment it and write back 52, right? So most of the times that will happen. But sometimes this can happen, right? So what just happened? This is called a race condition. That is when multiple threads execute on the same piece of data at the same time, different results can happen depending on which thread races first, right? This thread finished first and that thread is lagging behind. This got interrupted. Depending on what happens, a lot of bad stuff can happen and your results will be very non-deterministic. So such pieces of code that can lead to race conditions are called critical sections. And what we need when we are executing a critical section, so this incrementing a counter, that is a critical section. And when you're executing a critical section, what we need is a property called mutual exclusion. That is, if one thread is in the critical section, we want another thread to wait outside. We don't want multiple threads executing in the critical section, executing the same line of code at the same time. This property is also called atomicity. That is, you want the critical section to be executed in one go without anybody else coming in and disturbing you while you're executing the critical section. It should execute like one uninterruptible instruction. Right? How does it happen? In real life, you have no control. There's no way you can tell the operating system, hey, wait, you know, this is an important piece of code, don't disturb me, right? It's not easy to tell the operating system. It can interrupt you at any point of time. Therefore, for such things, we need a special mechanism called locking, which is the topic of the next lecture. So unless you have things like locks in place, writing multi-threaded code correctly is impossible because all sorts of weird things, all sorts of race conditions can occur when you're incrementing a counter, as simple as incrementing a counter, or in general making any changes to shared data structures.